Hello, everyone. Thank you. As you mentioned, my research interest is in software engineering, especially in facilitating collaboration between all the team members of a software project. And that's not a trivial matter, which might best be illustrated by this quote, which is kind of, in my opinion, one of the best definitions of software engineering, of what software development is actually all about. There's lots of very technical definitions of software engineering. This one is focusing much more on the process of getting from ideas to software. And that's like a very large cognitive gap, if you will, because ideas are something that we have in our heads, that our clients have in our heads, if we are developing software for clients. And so software development is essentially, well, creating software is creating this embodied knowledge, taking ideas out of people's heads, which might be kind of fuzzy, which might be dispersed between different people. So different people have different ideas. Different people might have different requirements. Different people might have different opinions on what a certain software product is supposed to do. And people might not even be aware that they have these requirements. If you go to a large company that needs a particular piece of software, and you talk to different stakeholders in management, among the users, among the quality assurance people, among the operations people, among the maintenance people, they will all have very different perspectives on this product or on this process that's supposed to be supported by software. And some of that knowledge might even be incomplete. That is, there might be situations that nobody thought of. There might be situations that have not been foreseen. But then all of this somehow needs to be supported by software. And taking all these ideas, taking all this knowledge, this kind of incomplete, tacit, latent knowledge, and putting it into code, which is kind of like the most precise way you can think of, or the most precise way you can get in expressing how something works, is a very large gap to go from these very fuzzy ideas to this very precise, extremely structured code that you actually implement later on when you're building software. And that's really what software engineering is all about. Understand what people need, put that into code, and usually that's not a straightforward process, but it's very much a process of discovery, or as Howard Bettis said, a process of social learning. That is, the team that's building the software is learning along the way what actually are the requirements for the software and what might be the best ways of building the software. Now, the issue with this is, especially when we're talking about large projects, not so much when we're talking about startups, and also not so much when we're talking about projects like QuizUp or so, where like one team is developing their own product, but like when we're mostly when we're talking about teams that are developing software for others, so like someone developing software for the healthcare domain, for the insurance domain, for the medical domain, or any other large complex domain that has large processes, the challenge is for the software engineers to understand what's really going on in that client domain, in that business domain. And typically, and these are the problems that software engineers have been grappling with the last few decades. They have been described already in the 80s when there was barely any Windows around, barely any, let alone any mobile devices around. People were already complaining about thin spread of application domain knowledge, about lack of communications between developers and business people. And so these things, poor overview of the business domain, insufficient understanding of the constraints and uncertainties, negligence of anything that's like really valuable to the client and favoring on that, that's easy to do. These are kind of issues that have been with us for a long time in software engineering. Of course, initially people tried to solve this by following plan-driven approaches, that is specifying as much as possible from the start, trying to figure out what exactly the users want, writing it up in documents that they could stack up from the floor in hundreds of pages and saying, this is our specification, this is what our software needs to do, and then building that. And people soon figured out that doesn't really work, because in the beginning of a project, we don't really have much of an idea for what should the software be doing, what exactly are our processes, how do they work. So we can't really specify all that. And even if we produce that much paper, even if we do specify all that, half of that knowledge might be overturned by developments that occur as we're actually building the thing. And the other half might be trivial. So people say, yes, I know all this. I don't need to read all this because it's obvious how the software is supposed to work. And like the really tricky parts that are kind of hidden in this whole tome of paper are easily overlooked. So those things that are really critical don't really stand out in such a huge piece of specification. Along came Agile, and Agile people said, well, we don't actually need all this paper, we don't need all these documents. we mostly need people who communicate very closely with each other, communicate very closely with the client. And so we trying to discover the project along the way with figuring out how the project is supposed to way to work along the way. That works a bit better, at least for certain classes of projects. But it also has a problem that we're encouraged to talk in agile projects, but we're not really told like what to talk about. What are the most important things to talk about? What should be the focus of our discussion in agile projects? That's something that all the agile methods are pretty silent on. So they tell us to talk each day about what we've been working on, what's in our way, what our plans are. But to make sure that we're really talking about the key issues and that we're not talking about the things that are occupying us at the moment is something that agile methods don't really give us any guidance on. What we really need in a successful project is to have a good understanding of what are the things that are really critical for project success, that is what's most important to the client, and what's most likely to break our neck in the next 1, 2, 3 weeks or so. And to recognize what are these value and effort drivers, which is something that you don't get by just looking at a technical model of a system. It's something that you don't get just by talking to people, because even customers might not be quite sure what those are when you ask them so abstractly. So what are your value drivers? What are your effort drivers? And you want to eliminate all the risks, all the uncertainties, and all the things that can go wrong. At the University of Iceland here, in cooperation with the University of Duisburg-Essen, we have developed this concept of the interaction room, which is a form of team room, or like an extension of a team room, where people are working on whiteboards, manipulating and visualizing the product on a number of whiteboards that focus on different aspects of the software. So we are focusing on essentially four different perspectives, that is the business processes that the software is supposed to support, the objects of interest, the business objects, everything that the software is dealing with in the application domain, the whole environment of the system that the system will be integrated in. Typically, you're building one component that's part of a much larger application landscape that it has to focus and integrate on, and the interaction canvas, which models everything that stakeholders or users will be able to do with the system. So you have dialogues, menus, navigation patterns, and so on. And of course, you have the product backlog as you would have in any agile project. That doesn't look so different from a conference room of a team room. The focus here is that this is not a classic conference room, so we don't have like a huge table where people just sit and wait through their meeting or check their email through the meeting. As Gunnar said, we're not having a meeting, we're having a conference. That's something we're trying to avoid here. We would like people to be in front of the board. We want people to be in front of the walls, talking, interacting, not having a conference, but being active on these whiteboards to model and sketch their system. One thing is, you might say, well, okay, we have a team room, we are used to doing models, we're used to modeling parts of our system, and is modeling supposed to be a bad word in Agile anyway? The key here is that we're trying to do away with something that has been kind of a given in at least academic circles when we're talking about software and software modeling. We're trying to get rid of all this formality, consistency, completeness that people typically associate with modeling. So when you talk about system models and like object models, business process models, people imagine these huge tapestries that you put on top of on the wall and which kind of reflect your whole system and try to model your whole system in exquisite detail. But which, especially in the early phases of a project, you don't have enough knowledge to build. And even if you have, people simply won't understand what's going on there because half of the people are either not technical or are not business people and so won't understand these processes. What we're trying to do is to figure out what's like the middle ground that both the business people and the technical people can understand in order to communicate about their requirements and about the challenges that come about in implementing these requirements. To make sure that we kind of have something that is understandably by all the people in the room, by all the people on the team, whether they come from management, whether they come from operations, whether they come from the user side. Of course, that's not supposed to be a replacement for more formal specifications. So in some projects, you might not need any more formal specifications. Those projects that you would usually do in a more agile fashion, you can simply stay on this very high level. on other projects where you would usually want to model things because you have very critical processes, say in the healthcare domain or so, where it's crucial that you understand exactly what's going to happen in which order, in which time, so you'll want to model those processes, and you find you can still do that, but you wouldn't do it in this team room, in this interaction room, but you would realize this is a spot that we need to focus on. So we'll have like a few experts going down to a room of themselves, modeling the process, coming back, introducing the process to the people. So you kind of focus attention where it's needed, and usually you're fine on this level and only need to go down to the formal level in very specific spots. So what we're trying to do is to have these models in the interaction room as kind of a catalyst for the understanding of all people and for a way to realize what are actually these value and complexity drivers and what are actually the risks and uncertainties, and how can we talk about these without the business people feeling left out after 10 minutes because the technical guys are going into all kinds of technical details, or the technical guys not understanding everything because the business people are discussing some arcana about legal requirements. What do these models look like? We have on these walls, as I mentioned, these different canvases, and usually they're pretty simple, pretty straightforward. We have this process canvas for modeling the business processes. We have an object canvas where we model all the object relationships. And usually they don't need to be very complex. It's an integration canvas, for example, here for a health insurance management system, which just tells us, okay, which systems are integrating with our system, which are our interfaces with the system. And for the first level of understanding, for the first initial project scoping phases, where it's just a matter of understanding how complex this project's going to be, how much budget we need, who we're going to involve in this project, what the key tricky parts are, these models are sufficient enough and we don't need to get into any more modeling detail. And probably even if you don't, if you're not in the healthcare domain, if you don't understand much, you kind of see, okay, this looks like a pretty complex system in terms of both the objects that it's dealing with, in terms of the interfaces it has to outside systems. So you can already tell this is going to be quite a complex project, quite a tricky project. So this all doesn't look like rocket science. And so far, this all you might say, well, it doesn't really help me along. So like modeling or different levels of abstraction is not really something that's a huge innovation in a way, you might say. That's true. And this also still doesn't tell us where are the really tricky parts, where's the really uncertain parts about this project. And that's where annotations come in, which is the second level of detail we use in the interaction room. We give everyone on the team like a stack of these annotations. These are like little sticky notes, size of a regular sticky note. And we encourage people to tag these onto these models to indicate where they would see value drivers, where they would see effort drivers, where they would see risk drivers, and just point those out to each other on these models. And so we have like things like, I don't know, this would be value orientation. This is something that's important for the business. This is something important for the users. Security aspects, reliability aspects, particular legal constraints or policy constraints, things that have certain time constraints, usability, or things like in a larger system landscape, systems that you're not supposed to touch. You might be wondering, okay, if we build this new system, some things we can change among other systems, some things we can't change. And especially in a large organization, you might have legacy systems that are not supposed to be touched anymore because either there's very little knowledge left in the company for how these systems work. True story, happens in German banks all the time. They have components in COBOL that nobody really knows how they work. People know what goes in, people know what goes out, but nobody wants to touch them and nobody wants to maintain them because the COBOL programmers are slowly all retiring. Or you might have systems that you want to retire and you say, well, this is something we can't rely on anymore. You might have external interfaces. You might have particular complexity. You might have parts of a process that need to be done by people that can't be automated. And so each of these annotations, some of them are business focused, some of them are technology focused, can be tagged onto the models by the stakeholders, by the people who are collaborating in such a room. And so they can shift the attention from what you typically see in a model. So when you look at this model, you just say, whoa, complexity. And you can shift the attention away from that to the things that are really important and really critical. Because when you look at a model like this, and you might say, well, yeah, it's complex, and like this part here looks more complex than that part. But often the visual complexity of a model doesn't really tell you a lot about the actual complexity of the system, because people tend to model, if you just let them, what they understand best. So like if you model a complex system, then these parts here, which have like all this intricate detail, that's probably where everyone knew exactly what they were doing. And they said, yes, that's where we have these associations and those relations and the following detailed aspects in here. So that's probably something that everybody understands. Yet it looks the most complex in this model. Other parts, like here, we have something that looks very straightforward, just like something with lots of contributing factors. But people might not really know what's in all of these boxes. So this is something that's very little understanding maybe on the team behind it. And because there is so little understanding, people didn't model that much. The resulting thing is just in the end result, this looks like the easiest part of the system, which is something that's deceptive about system models, especially when you start modeling in an early phase, that the visual complexity of the model on the wall is typically not the actual implementation complexity. And that's something that we can counteract with these annotations by taking a model like this. It's in German, but you don't need to understand what the model is about to understand what the team is facing here in this challenge when you see all the annotations that the team put here. And soon you see after like the result of such a workshop, even without knowing what this project is about or what health insurance is about, you realize this is the part where people thought was most critical. It has a value annotation, business value and user value. It has complexity. So this is something that's obviously very important to the business, very important to the users, and at the same time considered very complex, which is the product, incidentally. It's just like very small, little, innocent thing up there in the corner, which you wouldn't have thought that that's probably where the team is going to spend a lot of effort later on. Same here. This is something that looks much more complex. This is something now you realize we can't touch this, so everything needs to kind of be designed around that because we can't adapt this part. This we have no idea how this works, uncertainty. This one will have to be changed later on. Here we have to reflect certain legal constraints. And suddenly, even without understanding what the domain is about, you realize where the team will probably focus the implementation and the design and the specification effort on. And that's something that's also valuable for the team, because before this workshop, the team also didn't really know where these hotspots might be. So they would go into the system and say, well, yes, we're modeling a project, we're modeling a product, we're modeling certain contracts, we're putting information into and out of a database, how hard can it be? Most information systems on the surface look very trivial, it's just data in and out. But then in the business processes and all the legal constraints, technical constraints, that's where you have the complexity that can make or break a product. Same here, integration landscape, for example, all the interfaces around the system. Again, like as a team, you would think all these interfaces look kind of similar, but now you realize nobody has any idea how this is supposed to work. Here we have particular complexity in the self-service portal. This is something that needs to be very flexible, security constraints, many different partners here, legal requirements on something that's extremely important to the company, something that cannot or should not be automated, and so on. And suddenly you realize all these different challenges. Something we also do that's not shown here is when people annotate these models, they also voice their opinions, they voice their concerns about these issues, and we document these issues, put them into a spreadsheet that people can refer to later on. So the benefit of this is twofold. One thing is we typically do this in the very early stages of the project before we start even estimating. So like when you're in an agile project, even before you start estimating your product backlog, that's when you would have such a workshop in order to understand what's our project about, what's the complexity in our project, where are these value and effort drivers, and what exactly are those. We keep tables with a list for all these value and effort drivers, what exactly is the point we're trying to make here. And that's vital information to have for the estimation, because then you realize, okay, this looks trivial on the surface, but actually there's lots of architectural challenges, lots of security challenges maybe down the road, so we will probably have to invest more effort into this particular feature. Or this other feature might have much higher value to the user than it might look on the surface if we better prioritize this higher. So all this knowledge is very important in effort estimation and in prioritization of our backlog items. And also because we document it, we can get back to it later on when it's actually time to implement that feature. So like maybe like 7 sprints down the road, which might be like half a year later, we come back to implementing that particular feature. And we might remember there was something in that initial meeting that people said, be careful, this is going to be tricky. And we can go back to the list of annotations and say, okay, what exactly were those constraints that the business people had? What exactly were those technical issues that the operations guys mentioned? We have this knowledge still available and explicit in the system, which is knowledge that typically you wouldn't have, because when you consider how you're building software, whether you're following a plan-driven approach, you have lots of models. None of that information is in the model. It's not visible in the model. It's simply usually gut feelings of developers, gut feelings of business people, assumed to be self-evident, assumed to be to be obvious, but not really obvious maybe to the people who are actually building the software. So this way you make this knowledge explicit. And if you're following an agile approach, and maybe some of these things you would talk about to people, but you would talk about and you would realize in sprint 5, in sprint 7, when it's really time to build this, and then you suddenly realize, wow, there's something more under the surface that's gonna give us a hard time now. Now this way you have done this very early in the project, and you can benefit from it later on. The way we do this is a very simple workshop format, can be done in 1 day or so. Collect all the requirements, collect all the features, at least on a very rough level. Then we see like how exactly do these features translate into business processes, into business objects, into integration interfaces, and so on. So we fill all those canvases of the room. Then we annotate, typically in different rounds, because we can't give people like 20 annotations at once and say, here, put whatever you like on there. But we pre-select the annotations and say, well, these 5 or 7 annotations are the ones that are critical for this project. And so we ask stakeholders to put those on. We have a separate round for these uncertain annotations, so those question marks, because experience shows people don't really like to put question marks onto the model and thereby like admitting, well, I'm not sure about this. Whether it's business people who feel like I should understand this process, so I can't really put a question mark there, or whether it's technical people who say, well, I can't put a question mark here because the business people who are hiring me think I'm not competent. But by forcing people to at least in this last uncertainty round to each put at least one question mark on the wall, you're surprised sometimes where those question marks cluster, and which like things that everyone or nobody ever mentioned before suddenly becomes clustered with question marks, and you realize that there's one component that nobody really understands. And that's very important knowledge to have before you start estimating, before you start prioritizing. Because then you might also figure out things like, based on these combinations for annotations, there are other things that might be actually like quick wins or so to implement, because it's very valuable, no risks in there, low complexity, so we can build this very quickly and get something that everybody enjoys. One example, so this approach originally developed at in an academic setting, but then applied lots of times in industry settings. One example at a company that develops software for the health insurance sector. So for one thing, this is how these things look in practice, like when you have a huge room with whiteboards where people model their system. And this is in a project where people followed an agile approach. So far, so good. And you know these agile burndown charts where at the beginning of a sprint you say, well, we have maybe here like 40 tasks, and then we burn down these tasks and we note how we are doing as we are completing tasks and making sure that we finish before the sprint is over. Well, in this case here, you see it didn't go so well. Like in the beginning, the team went quite well. So like everything looked quite good. And then suddenly this explosion of tasks here happened where people realized, well, we're actually not done yet. There is other things to do. And the reason for that is usually here the number of tasks should remain constant, this red line. What actually happened, the team kept discovering tasks, things to do throughout the sprint. And not just like a few tasks, like here's 40. That went up to like 100 tasks in total, like way beyond the flip chart there, things that people realize they have to do in order to complete that job. And of course, you can't really plan a project like this. The whole agile approach doesn't work when you keep discovering things to do throughout the project. In this case, this team always had the problem that about 25% of tasks on average were discovered not before the sprint, but mid-sprint some way, which was overturning all their plans. And once we worked with them to have these initial workshops before each sprint planning meeting, they would go through one of these workshops and figure out, okay, what are our value drivers, our risk drivers, our effort drivers, and how does that translate into things to do, into tasks? They could push this amount of tasks that were discovered only during the sprint, from something like 1/4 of all tasks to 6% of tasks, and that helped them to become much more reliable in the estimates and much more reliable in the delivery deadlines, not like you being way past the deadline. So this is something how this worked quite well in one of these projects. What we're doing academically is to see how we can combine this with more digital methods, like here with digital whiteboards, that you can draw on, because of course physical whiteboards are limited in space, and so we're trying to see how this can work with digital whiteboards that you can draw on, that you can zoom, pan, and thereby be more flexibly working with information. Okay, so far so good. If you have any questions, or if that might be interesting for you to try in your projects, feel free to contact me anytime. Thank God for your attention, and I'll be happy to answer any questions. Tack.